Hi, everyone. My name is Stacey Gifford, and I'm a research staff member at IBM Research. And as a scientist, I often ask myself the question of how is the work that I'm doing impacting the world around me? And I think that this is an important question to ask. So today we're going to try and answer it for one of the fastest growing areas of research, which is AI or artificial intelligence, and one of the biggest problems that we have to address today, which is climate change. So we're going to ask the question of how can AI help solve climate change? And full disclosure, I'm a chemist, so we're going to focus on how we can use AI to develop new materials to help solve climate change. So we're going to call this the chemistry edition. Okay. So before we dive in, let's talk a moment about the problem at hand. So most of you probably already know this, but climate change is the observed increase in global temperature that we've observed over time. And if we look at the curve over the past 100 years or so, it looks something like this. And we know that we're on track today to hit a 1.5 degrees Celsius increase in temperature by 2040. And that's not very far away. And while 1.5 degrees Celsius may not seem like a whole lot of change, we know that this is going to lead to more extreme events like hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, etc. Okay? So we need to address this problem urgently. And at its core, this is really a chemistry problem. So the reason that we're seeing this increase in global temperature is due to rising greenhouse gases and primarily carbon dioxide. Now we can solve this problem in two ways. We can either mitigate it, which means that we stop it before it happens, or we can adapt, which means we deal with it once it's here. And from a materials and chemistry perspective, really what we want to do is mitigate. We want to develop new materials and new chemistries that can help solve climate change and stop it from happening. And there's a couple different ways we can do this. So there are what we call low carbon technologies. And this includes things like green chemistry that can be synthesized with lower carbon emissions and produce things that are more environmentally friendly. It also includes things that operate with less energy requirements. So if you think of something that's more aerodynamic, it's going to require less fuel, which means fewer carbon emissions. This also includes things like energy storage. And so this is batteries, which are really critical for enabling renewable energy, which is an important part of how we're going to address climate change. And then finally, it includes things like carbon capture, utilization, and storage technologies. And these are materials that act a bit like a sponge or a membrane that separate out CO2 from either the atmosphere or point sources like power plants. And then the utilization and storage part is once we have that carbon dioxide in hand, we can either convert it into things that are useful, like drugs and new materials, or we can store it underground where it turns into rock and it's stable for millions of years. So these technologies all exist today in some capacity, but they've been limited by a couple of different challenges. And they can kind of be broken down into a couple key areas. So the first is performance. And one example of this is if you have a material like a solvent or a solid adsorber for carbon capture, usually you have to heat it up or pressurize it to release that CO2 back so you can go do something with it. And that requires fuel and it requires energy, and it means that you're actually emitting some carbon dioxide while you're capturing it. And we want to minimize that energy penalty as much as possible. And there's a lot of room for improvement today. We also have issues with toxicity. So if you think about the materials that go into batteries today, many of these are very toxic to the environment. So while we're solving one problem and helping to address renewable energy, we're creating other problems elsewhere in the system. Stability is another problem. So we know that many of these materials break down quickly over time. And ultimately, this all leads to an increase in cost. And in order to really drive large-scale adoption of these technologies, we need to bring the cost down. And at its core, all of these things are can be addressed by designing new materials and new processes. But if you think about doing that in a traditional laboratory setting, it becomes really complicated and almost overwhelming. So if we take one problem, right? So let's talk about creating a new solvent that's better than any other solvent on the market today for carbon capture. The solvent space alone has thousands of candidates that already exist today, even if we don't discover a completely new one. And then if we start talking about solvent blends where you're mixing two or three of these together to get better performance, now you're talking about millions of different combinations. And that's not even considering the processes and the operating conditions that these work under. So you can improve the pH, the temperature, the pressure, the concentration of CO2, all of those things have an impact on performance. And so now you're starting to talk about millions of different experiments that have to be performed. And this becomes an incredibly hard problem to solve on an experimental level. And this is really where AI comes into the picture. So if we go back to our high school science class and we think about the sort of tried and true scientific method, it looks a little bit something like this, right? So you have a question, you have a hypothesis, you test that hypothesis with experiments, you observe the results, and then you draw some conclusions. And then we iterate through this many, many times before we really decide on some fundamental conclusions from our experiments. So this can take a long time to do, especially if you have lots of different conditions that you have to try. And we can use AI to speed this process up and make it work better. So the first place that we can use AI is in the question and hypothesis generation part. So we can use techniques like natural language processing to ingest thousands of journal articles that exist out there, which is really sort of the foundation of our scientific knowledge, and start to link entities so we can link materials and different properties and their performance metrics and other properties and build knowledge graphs. And these allow us to explore the literature in a way that's much more meaningful than if you were to have a single scientist reading through journal article after journal article. Because if you think about it, if a scientist is going out to create a new solvent for carbon capture, they're going to read the carbon capture literature first and maybe the solvent literature. But they're probably not going to explore a whole lot beyond that because there's just too much to look at. But if you have a way of ingesting all of that literature and linking it up all together, then you can really start to make insights in new areas using other materials that maybe nobody's looked at before. And that's really where the interesting and exciting hypotheses come from. We can also use query technologies to start to ask interesting questions. So we can say, what is the best performing solvent on the market today? And it's probably going to tell us MEA because that's what's most widely used. But there could be other candidates that get linked up through those entity recognitions to help bring to light new materials that nobody's really looked at before. So that's one area. The second area is that we can start to predict new materials. And we can do this through generative modeling. And this allows us to set boundaries and say, we want a material that has these properties or these performance metrics. And we can start to predict new chemistries and new materials that meet those requirements. We can also use data-driven techniques like machine learning to bring in large data sets. So say we have a data set on the performance of thousands of solvents. We can start to look at how we mix those together to actually predict new mixtures that can outperform what's there today. And then we can use other techniques like quantum chemistry. And this can allow us to predict single properties of materials and how they might perform and rank them against each other. Then we can start to look at their performance. So we can assess them and downselect. And this is really before we even get into a chemistry lab. So we can use AI-enhanced simulation. To predict how different materials will perform under certain conditions. So for example, if we're able to predict new candidates of monomers that can perform that can create a polymer that we can use as a membrane to separate CO2 from nitrogen, we can simulate that membrane, and then we can look at its permeability and selectivity for carbon dioxide versus nitrogen versus NOx versus SOx versus other contaminants. And we can do this in a way that's higher throughput than we could do in a laboratory setting. And it's much cheaper because we don't have to go create all of these membranes from scratch. And this really drives up the efficiency. So we know that this increases efficiency several orders of magnitude. And it makes a big difference on our ability to discover new materials. And then finally, when we actually do want to move into the real world and start thinking about creating things, we can use AI-enhanced synthesis and automated labs to speed this up. So using AI-enhanced synthesis means that we can use predict retrosynthetic pathways to predict the best ways to make new materials, and best can mean a lot of different things, right? So it could be that it's the cheapest way to make it, or it's the most environmentally friendly way to make it, or it's the purest way to make it. And then once we have those conditions, we can go into an automated lab and synthesize them in a high throughput manner, and then also test their performance. And really what this means is that we're able to both validate and we can generate data. And that data can feed back into both our knowledge graph so that we get a better understanding of the full picture of the scientific knowledge that's out there, and also into our models so that we can be better at predicting new materials moving forward. And so hopefully what you're seeing here is that the same cycle that we use for the scientific method is replicated in the AI-enhanced version of the scientific method. And I think what we're going to see over the next couple of years is that this process is really going to accelerate discovery, and we're going to see significant impact on how we address climate change with new materials. Thanks. Thank you. If you have any questions, please drop us a line below. And if you want to see more videos like this in the future, please like and subscribe. If you want to learn more about AI for climate change, please visit the links in the description.